Welcome back to Scout Report, where today we're looking at how to fix Barcelona. The 2019-20 season was a telling one for fans of Barcelona. Not only did the club lose out on the La Liga title, but were clearly second best to Real Madrid throughout the campaign, played some of the least inspiring football seen at the Camp Nou in recent memory, and sacked their manager midway through the season for the first time since 2003. The Blaugrana have ended 1920 with their worst La Liga points total since 2008, while the same can be said for their goal tally, and posted only the fifth best defensive record in the division, their lowest placing in this metric in 17 years. They also failed to reach the Copa del Rey semi-finals for the first time in 11 seasons, and by the end of June had already completed another piece of baffling transfer business, effectively swapping a 23-year-old Artur for a 30-year-old Miralem Pjanic in a bizarre exercise of balancing the books. In past scout reports, we've looked at the side's over-reliance on Messi and how they can become one of the very best in Europe again. But there is clearly a long way to go, and the problems which have dogged the club in recent years, while well publicised, are deep-rooted. Following what could be a first trophyless season in over a decade, the Blaugrana will have to face a number of different challenges in the immediate and long term as they attempt to regain the ground they have lost. From finances and transfer policy to squad building and the manager. Let's have a look at how they can tackle some of them. Stick with Setién. Less than 6 months into the job, Quique Setién has already faced calls to be sacked as Barcelona manager. Captain Lionel Messi is rumoured to want the former Betis man replaced in the Camp Nou dugout, and while club president Josep Bartomeu insists he is going nowhere for the time being, he has also admitted that Barca legend Xavi will manage the club sooner or later. But while we weren't huge fans of Setién's appointment midway through the season, there also seems little reason for him to be let go after such a short time in charge. The most obvious candidate to rejuvenate the Barcelona project in the long term, Mauricio Pochettino, turned down the club's advances back in January, while Erik ten Hag, who is generally seen as a perfect fit stylistically, would likely demand assurances the club won't be able to give with a presidential election coming up in 2021. So while it feels like Setién only has a year left in the job at most, changing the managerial position again before the 2020-21 season would be silly. The Spanish coach has had a difficult start to life at the Camp Nou, to say the least. After he was hired, it quickly became clear he was the fourth choice for the job. And within weeks of him taking over, Barca became embroiled in political turmoil, following a public dispute between Lionel Messi and sporting director Eric Abidal, which nearly saw the Frenchman lose his job and raised concerns over Messi's future. Furthermore, Setién was left with a depleted squad, with Luis Suarez requiring surgery that kept him out for 6 months. The club also sold forwards Carles Perez and Abel Ruiz without signing a single replacement, an issue which was eventually addressed with the controversial acquisition of Martin Braithwaite, and loaned out Carles Alenya and Jean-Claire Todibo. On top of this, Spanish football was suspended 11 games into his tenure, meaning the coach hasn't been able to work with his squad continuously for longer than 2 months. So considering this, it's hard to knock him. A known disciple of Johan Cruyff, Setién has quickly turned Barca back into a possession-heavy side. Under his tutelage, the Blaugrana have averaged 69% of the ball, the highest figure in Europe. And while this hasn't seen the side produce more in the final third, with their goals per game actually dropping to 1.8 compared with their average of 2.6 during Valverde's final months, it has helped in keeping the opposition out. Under Setién, Barca are conceding 0.8 goals a match, down from 1.2 under Valverde, while they have kept 10 clean sheets in 19 league outings since he was hired in January, compared with just 5 in the 19 before that. There has also been a much bigger emphasis on pressing, with Setién utilising high-energy players like Arturo Vidal to force opponents into mistakes in their own half, and implementing a higher defensive line, whereas Valverde liked to invite the opposition to attack before breaking from deep. Before the suspension of La Liga in March, Barca were allowing opponents on average just 7.5 passes per defensive action. As a result, they conceded 9.8 shots a game in 2019-20 compared with 10.8 the previous season. Had Setien had the whole campaign with the side, no doubt that figure would be even lower. And while there have been a fair share of disappointing performances under Setien, especially from an attacking standpoint, there are also signs that he can get the side performing at least near the level we've seen in better seasons. At the beginning of July, they tore apart a strong Villarreal side, winning 4-1. Barca enjoyed 68% of the ball and passed the Yellow Submarine off the park, completing 93% of the 821 they attempted. They also took 18 shots, putting 12 on target to their opponent's 4, and created 15 chances in total, up from their average of 11 this term, with Lionel Messi playing as a roaming 10 behind Suarez and Griezmann, the only time this specific combination has been used under Setien. So clearly the Barcelona we grew to love in the early 2010s isn't totally dead and buried. And given time, Setien can leave the side in a much better state than he found it for whoever succeeds him, whether it be Xavi or someone else. However, in order for the tactical changes he has made to be effective in the long term, major surgery needs to be done. But before we move on to our next section, just a quick reminder to, if you haven't already, subscribe to EFD and hit that notification bell so you never miss another video. Trust in youth. One of the main things holding Setien back from making real progress at the Camp Nou is the fact some players simply aren't up to playing a high-pressing style over 90 minutes consistently. And while some may attribute recent signs of this at least partly to fatigue from the post-lockdown schedule, it remains true that implementing this tactic requires a lot of time and effort. Just look at how long it took Man City, Liverpool and Tottenham to get up to speed with the methods of Guardiola, Klopp and Pochettino. On top of this, the Barca squad has been aging for some time, which makes radically improving fitness levels an even tougher challenge. With an average age of 27.4, the Blaugrana possess the 6th oldest squad in the Spanish top flight, and have fielded a starting lineup with an average age of over 30 three times in 2019-20. Only Eibar, whose squad has an average age of 29.4, have done it more. The spine of the team hasn't really changed at all in the last decade, with Messi, Busquets and Piqué still ranking among the club's top 5 appearance makers. Of the top 8 appearance makers, just one player is under the age of 28, Clement Longley, and of the top 15, only 2 are under 25, Frankie de Jong and Arthur, who is effectively being replaced by a 30-year-old Miralem Pjanic. Nearly half of them are 31 or older. This is the result of the club's wayward transfer policy, which has seen them overpay massively for established stars to boost their attack in the short term, namely Antoine Griezmann, or settle for subpar alternatives to the real deal, like targeting Andre Gomez over Marco Verratti in 2016. 2 years earlier, in Andoni Zubizarreta's final summer as director of football before he was sacked by Bartomeu, the club bought Luis Suarez, Marc-Andre ter Stegen and Ivan Rakitic. In the 5.5 years between then and January 2020, they made 27 permanent signings. None have been as successful as those three, while you could only argue that Samuel Umtiti, Clement Longley, Nelson Semedo and Frankie de Jong have been good investments at all. So just 15% of their transfer activity in over half a decade has proven in any way successful, while the acquisitions of Dembele, Coutinho and Griezmann, bought for a combined €403 million, have been nothing short of disastrous. Between them, they have amassed 56 goals and assists in nearly 9,000 league minutes, amounting to a goal involvement every 157 minutes. Hardly world-beating stuff. Meanwhile, old heads like Busquets and Piqué, while still technically sound, no longer have the mobility to deal with tough, high-pressing opposition. Clearly, the club needs to invest exclusively in players under 25 to ensure a return to a more expansive style of play can be sustained for years to come. And while the makeup of the squad can't be changed overnight in the transfer market, utilising the young players the club already has will help. Midfielder Ricky Puig picked up more regular minutes towards the end of the campaign, but at nearly 21 years of age, has only made 7 league starts in total for the Blaugrana. But while his limited minutes make it hard to get the best picture of him as a player, the data we do have is promising. He completes nearly 3 dribbles per 90, more than Arthur, takes nearly 2 shots, and is also a hard-working ball winner in Setien's system, recording 6.3 successful pressures each game, more than Fabinho manages for Liverpool, and makes 3.4 tackles and interceptions. While his tackle success rate of 44% is far from ideal, this will only improve with more game time, especially if he and Frankie de Jong can form a strong bond. And in attack, we've already seen what Ansu Fati is capable of in 2019-20. The 17-year-old winger, who joined La Masia aged 10, is the club's 5th top scorer in the league with 7 goals, despite ranking 15th in the squad for minutes played. He's also sustained 0.61 expected goals and assists per 90, ranking him 3rd behind Messi and Suarez. In short, he looks like a star in waiting, and while some may argue his numbers are inflated from playing alongside Messi, the experience of playing regularly with the Argentinian at such a young age will do wonders for his development, as will competing with the incoming Francisco Trincão, the 20-year-old winger signed for €31 million from Braga. But with a number of talents being sold off from La Masia in recent years, there is worryingly little scope for bringing down the average age in other areas of the side, especially if current reports about how the club plans to conduct the summer transfer window are true. Efficient squad building. Unsurprisingly, Barcelona's reckless spending in recent seasons has been compounded by the global health crisis. By the end of May, they had already lost €154 million in revenue, facilitating the need to make the Artur Pjanic deal happen in order to post a profit at the end of the financial year. The club is also saddled with massive debt and still have the hugely expensive revamp of the Camp Nou in development. Add to this the highest wage bill in world football, which amounts to an average of €11 million a year per player, and it's no wonder the club apparently needs to raise €124 million in player sales this summer. However, what makes less sense is their determination to use these sales to fund the signing of Lautaro Martinez, when they still lack a creator in midfield and have worryingly little cover at centre-back, at least if they sell to Debo and Coutinho, as is currently being reported. Lautaro would clearly be a great fit at the Camp Nou, but will cost upwards of €100 million, and while player exchanges could lessen the financial burden for Barca, aging squad members on big wages who would be ideal to offload in these circumstances, like Rakitic and Vidal, don't suit Inter's needs. Barca could find much better value elsewhere. For example, Real Madrid's Luka Jovic is available at a cut price this summer, but is understood to be on wages of over €150,000 per week, while his reported attitude problems may be a sticking point. Borussia Mönchengladbach's Marcus Thuram is also valued around €50 million, currently earns almost 3 times less, and unlike Jovic, is coming off a stellar season. The 22-year-old scored 10 and assisted 8 in the 1920 Bundesliga campaign, contributing to a goal every 123 minutes, playing as a centre-forward in a 4-3-1-2 or on the left wing in a 4-2-3-1. This versatility would be ideal for Setien. What's more, his expected goals and assists per 90 of 0.77 actually topped the 0.72 of Luis Suarez, the man Barca are trying to replace in the long term, and the 0.74 managed by Lautaro Martinez this season. And while Thuram's goal-scoring exploits don't match them, his creativity would be welcome in a Barca side which still relies massively on Messi in this regard. By targeting Thuram instead of Lautaro, Barca could make savings which would potentially allow players like Todibo and Coutinho to stay, in doing so bringing better balance to the squad. And even if they were to sell them, they could reinvest in defence and midfield, rather than throwing everything at the signing of Martinez. These suggestions only scratch the surface of the scale of change needed at Barcelona, and following the presidential elections next summer, the picture at the Camp Nou could look very different indeed. But if the club are to make positive, long-lasting changes to the way they operate on and off the field, they could do a lot worse than begin to implement those changes this summer. Transitioning from the club's win-it-all-costs approach of recent years could mean they miss out on more silverware next season, but it may be a necessary sacrifice. After all, the last time the club lost 2 La Liga titles in a row, between 2006 and 2008, Messi and Iniesta were developing into world-class players. If Barca want to become a genuinely world-beating side again, they may need to take a step back before moving forward. So that was our take on how to fix Barcelona, but what did you make of it? Let us know in the comments below. If you enjoyed this video, don't forget to leave it a like, and why not click on screen right now for another great Euro Football Daily video. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.